हरिओम। समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं भवानी शंकरो वंदे श्रद्धा विश्वासरूपिणो याभ्यां विना न पश्यन्ति सिद्धा स्वान्तस्तमीश्वरं वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनम् देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं रामाय रामभद्राय रामचंद्राय वेदसे रघुनाथाय नाथाय सीतायापतये नमः। बुद्धेर्बलं यशोधैर्यं निर्भयत्वमरोगता अजाड्यं वाक्पटुत्वं च हनुमत्स्मरणात् भवेत्। शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं। सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ नमः शिवाय 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 ॐ नमः शिवाय। नमः पार्वती पतये हर हर महादेव। हरिओम हरिओम। So we have started learning the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Vibhuti Yoga. In this chapter, Bhagwan will tell about his Vibhutis. So Bhagwan says that I will again give you that highest knowledge, because you have that great joy listening to me, Priyamanaya. So for your welfare, I will reveal this greatest knowledge again. Bhagwan says, even the great devatas, the Rishi Munis, they don't know me, they don't know my glories, they don't know my origin, means how everything originates from me, they do not know. Bhagwan says, one who knows me by my grace, they become free of all their bondage, all their sins, all their papa. So, yo mam ajam anadin cha vetti loka maheshwaram, one who knows me as ajam, unborn, anadim, beginningless, loka maheshwaram, the Lord, the master of this entire creation, asam moodas samarteshu, such a person is free from all delusion among all the mortals. And such person becomes free from all papa. Sarva papaihi pramuchyate. So we have to recognize Ishvara as our own self. And also we should recognize this whole world as Ishvara. So here in this chapter, as well as the following chapter, Bhagavan will show us that how he alone is present in this entire world and everything exists in him. As he had mentioned in the 9th chapter, ki maya tatamidam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina and masthani sarvabhutani, that I pervade this entire world in my unmanifest form and everything exists in me. So that Bhagavan demonstrates here in this chapter as well as the following chapter. So now Bhagavan is mentioning some of his vibhutis in the following verse, verse number 4. Buddhir jnanamasam mohaha Kshama satyam damashyamaha Sukham dukkham bhavo bhavaha Bhayam cha bhayam eva cha. Bhagavan says, one more verse we will chant. Ahimsa samata tushtihi Tapodanam yasho yashaha Bhavanti bhava bhutanam Matta eva pradhak vidhaha. Bhagavan says, all these bhavaha, all these expressions, Bhagavan mentions various expressions here. Bhagavan says, all these expressions have come from me alone. Bhavanti bhava bhutana Matta eva prathak vidha. All of them originated from me. All these various expressions have come from me. They are all expressions seen in different beings. We see this expression in all different types of beings. Bhavanti bhava bhutanam. But all of them have come from Ishvara alone. The expression differ from various beings depending on their own karma. Nana vidaha swakarmanurupena. According to their own karmas, these expressions are seen differently in different beings, but all of them have come from that Ishvara alone. Just as when you look at the sun, billions and millions of rays come out of that sun. And when we see these rays falling on different objects, they appear different. Even when the rays passes through some prism, they appear having different colors in them. Violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. But if you look at the sun, the light is only white, but when it passes through the prism, appears to have this variety of colors in them. But if you trace the source of all these colors, if you trace the source of all this light, then all this belongs to the sun alone. Similarly, in different beings, different expressions are seen, and all of them are quite amazing. But if you trace the source of these expressions, then Bhagwan alone is the source. Everything has come from that Supreme Ishvara alone. So that bhava should be kept in our mind all the time. So here Bhagwan enumerates few of these expressions. He says, buddhihi, buddhi, intellect, buddhi, jnanam, asammohaha, kshama, satyam, damah, shamah, sukham, dukham, bhavo, abhavah, bhayam, abhayam. So in this verse itself, Bhagavan mentions so many expressions. So buddhihi, the first expression mentioned here is buddhi. What is buddhi? Shankaracharya ji, he writes, ki antakaranasya sukshmadi arthava bodhana samarthyam tadvantam buddhiman itihi vadanti. He says it is the samarthya of our antakkarana, the ability of our antakkarana. See, we have this antakkarana, mana, buddhi, chitta, ahankar, which are within. They recognize things within. And we have the bahikkarana, the senses which recognize the objects outside. So buddhi is one of the expressions, one expression of the antakkarana. So what is it? He says it is that ability of this antakkarana to understand subtle objects, subtle things, sukshmadi arthava bodhana samarthyam, even subtle things, not only subtle but gross also, but it has got the ability to recognize and understand subtle aspects of ourself and this world. That is the very ability of this buddhi. See, with our senses we can just see the world, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. But because of this buddhi, we can infer things, we can compare, we can contrast, we can create a hypothesis and do experimentations. That's how the science also has progressed. The world which we are seeing as human beings and the world that is seen by the animals, birds, is the same world. But the human beings have progressed materially, outside, outwardly, creating machines and creating other facilities to help us in our life by using their buddhi. So buddhi is the ability to understand even the subtlest things of this world. later on in the 18th chapter also Bhagwan will talk about how this buddhi is able to differentiate and understand what is our kartavya karma and what is not our kartavya karma, which leads to bondage and what leads to freedom, what leads to fear and what gives us fearlessness, the ability to discriminate and understand what is papa, what is punya, what is good, what is bad. See, when we listen to the teacher, all of us listen to the same thing, but different students, they understand it differently, they grasp it differently depending on their ability of their intellect, the ability to grasp and understand differs. So one who has got a good grasping power and is able to understand the subtlest thing is called buddhiman. In the fourth chapter also we have seen Bhagwan calling the one who can differentiate between karma and akarma, sadsa buddhiman manushyeshu, is buddhiman among all human beings. So this buddhi is a part of this antakkarana, but this antakkarana has emerged from that Ishvara alone. Ishvara is not only the material which goes to make this buddhi, but Ishvara also gives the samarthya, the ability for this buddhi to function. And by Ishvara's grace alone, the buddhi functions. So all this we have to remember. Should not become proud, should not become vain. We should recognize the presence of divinity in our all these expressions. So buddhihi. Then Bhagwan mentions jnanam. See, using this buddhi, we gain knowledge. Jnanam. Atmadi padarthanam avabodhah. We come to recognize not only this world, but we have the ability to recognize our own self with the help of our buddhi. That knowledge which is gained is what is called jnanam here. See, buddhi is has got different quality. We say the buddhi is sukshma, or the buddhi is tikshna, or the buddhi is shuddha. Tikshna buddhi means sharp intellect. Sukshma buddhi means subtle intellect. In order to recognize our own self, we need a subtle intellect, the ability to distinguish between self and what is not the self, between the seer and the seen. That ability to distinguish between the seer and seen, if that buddhi has got this ability, then that buddhi is called sukshma buddhi. If the buddhi is able to distinguish between one object of this world and another, even the subtle objects of this world, then it is tikshna buddhi. And when the antakarana has good values like ahimsa, satyam, asteya, brahmacharya, parigraha, free from raga, dvesha, then that is called shuddha buddhi. We need sukshma buddhi and shuddha buddhi to recognize our own self. So all that knowledge which we gain using our buddhi is called jnanam here, and that jnanam is also expression of Bhagwan only. Bhagwan himself is jnana swarupa. and that Jnana Swarupa Bhagavan alone expresses as different knowledge in different beings. As Visheshat Jnana. Just as the sun is of the nature of light, and that light alone expresses reflected in different objects of this world. Similarly, Bhagavan himself is Jnana Swarupa, and that Jnana alone expresses as different Jnana in different beings. So all this Jnana is Bhagavan's Vibhuti alone. So Buddhir Jnanam, Buddhihi Jnanam, two Vibhutis Bhagavan mentioned here. Then Asammoha, free from moha, free from delusion, free from confusion. Here Shankaracharya ji defines Asammoha ki prati upapanneshu bodhavyeshu viveka purvika pravruttihi. That when we come across some situation or when we come across some objects, then to recognize it without getting confused. Recognize it with proper distinction without getting confused is what is called asammoha. So in this world we have to face different people, we have to face different objects, we have to face different situations. There are some situations which we have to face for the first time in life. Like now in the world people are facing this pandemic. We don't even remember when we had such a thing. Maybe a century ago. So when we have to face a new situation or situations, when we have to face different people and objects, we should face them with proper intelligence, proper understanding, without getting confused. We should be able to see things clearly as they are. We should be able to see people as they are. We should be able to evaluate the objects as they are, not get hyper about them, not become totally confused. So that ability of our intellect, of our antakkarana, to not get confused in different situations is what is called asammoha. See, in this modern times also, we get so many different types of stimuli from the world. Even from the television, if you look at the different channels giving news, one news, but different channels will be expressing it in different ways, depending on their own likes and dislikes, depending on their own fancy, depending on their own affiliation. So a person who is listening to all this will get thoroughly confused. So one should be able to understand things properly, evaluate them, and face them properly. That is also an ability of our own antakkarana. That's called asammoha. This comes when we do good satsang, when we study good books, when we interact with the wise and good people, then we can develop this ability within us. Satsangatve nissangatvam, nissangatve nirmohatvam. Through satsang we become nirmoha, free from all moha. So this is a very interesting and important quality. Bhagavan says it is my expression. I am expressing in you as asammoha in your antakkarana. See, sometimes we see the sun shining brightly in the sky and we see everything bright around. But at times the sun hides behind clouds. So we don't see the sun, but still we can see the whole world bright. So we should not mistake the clouds to be giving the light. Clouds are not illumining the sun, the world. The sun alone is illumining the world, though it is not seen. Even when the sun is about to rise, we don't see the sun. It is about to rise and all the darkness disappears. So darkness is eliminated by the sun alone, though it is not seen at times. Similarly, all these bhava are from Ishvara alone, though he is not seen. He is avyakta, he is unmanifest, but he is expressing through these various bhava, these various expressions. Remaining hidden, Bhagavan alone expresses as all this. So buddhir jnanam asammoha, then kshama, kshama, forgiveness. This is also a very beautiful quality of our antakkarana, that we are able to forgive other beings around, forgive things and situations, forgive the ancestors, devatas. Means, what is forgiveness? Shankaracharya ji, he writes, ki akrushtasya taditasya va avikruta chittata. That even when somebody criticizes us or hurts us in some way, our mind doesn't get agitated. Avikruta chittata, our mind doesn't get corrupted. Our buddhi doesn't get disturbed. That is what is called kshama. Means the person doesn't get corrupted by the different stimuli coming from this world or other being. It remains totally balanced. See, one thing we should understand, that whatever happiness or unhappiness we are experiencing in this world, they are all caused by my own karma. Though different people become nimitta to give me my results. That is how Bhagavan arranges the whole show. But basically, the cause of my sorrow is my papa karma, and cause of my joy is my punya karma. So, indirectly, I am responsible for all that I experience in my life. Other people become just a nimitta. So to get angry and to have that hatred and dislike and intense violence against them in our heart is not proper. No doubt, we should respond to different people differently according to their own personality and according to their own expression, but should not have that hatred or dislike in our own heart. See, this anger is like fire. The scriptures talk about anger as fire, agni. Now this fire has got a very strange expression, nature. Let us say you have a matchstick, and you strike it and light it. So you can see the fire. When the fire starts expressing, what does it do? It first burns the very place where it is expressing. Without burning the matchstick, fire will not manifest. It first burns the matchstick. And if it is thrown on some other object, then that object also, it is inflammable, it will catch fire. But if it is thrown in water, the fire gets extinguished. Similarly, when we have anger in our heart, the first thing it burns is our heart. And when we throw that anger towards some person, if that person is also volatile and inflammable, that fellow also starts getting angry. But if one throws this fire towards a person who is calm, peaceful, like water, the fire just gets extinguished there. So this anger is what arises when we have no forgiveness in our heart. Anger, hatred, impatience, dislike, intolerance, these are all expressions of non-forgiveness. Sometimes we carry our hurt and our pain throughout our life, not forgiving. People have that non-forgiveness towards their own so-called near and dear ones. Their own, sometimes own parents, brothers, sisters, neighbors, friends, relatives. Sometimes we have hatred towards our ancestors also, towards some devtas also. And sometimes people express their anger towards Ishvara also. Hey Ishvara, why did you create this world? I am very angry with you. दुनिया बनाने वाले क्या तेरे मन में समाये? काहे को दुनिया बनाई? So, when we carry this anger in our heart, then it keeps on burning our heart. So when our heart is burning, we will not experience peace and joy and calmness. We won't be able to sit and meditate. So we have to drop this hatred, anger by expressing the kshama, forgiveness. Forgiveness means from your side, you leave the karma and karma phala to Ishvara. Those who have hurt you, they have done karma, so let Ishvara give them the result. Why are you interfering with the process? See, even in the world, even if I see someone doing some crime, I don't have the right to punish that person. That right is there with the government, with the legal procedure and all should be done. A citizen cannot take law in their hand and punish some person. That is not proper. That will be another crime. Similarly, if somebody has done something wrong or hurt me, I cannot take the situation in my hand and punish that person. I can leave that thing to Ishwar. So that my antakarana becomes clean and pure, and I remain happy. Why should I suffer because of the foolishness and wrong actions of others around me? So it's a very interesting and very important that we understand what is forgiveness and cultivate this in our life. That will help us. That will definitely help us. One should, as I said, if somebody is doing something wrong or bad and this and you should deal with them accordingly. But without that hatred, without that anger, without the attitude of punishing them, but doing our duty. Just like when Arjuna came on the battlefield, he had hatred, dislike for that Duryodhana and his Kauravas. He wanted to punish them for what they did. So Bhagwan thought this is not a proper attitude. This war is not as a revenge or for punishment. It's a dharmic yuddha. With proper attitude, you have to fight this war. It has to be done. It's like an operation. The surgeon operates the patient not as a war or something, but just as a duty. So Bhagwan brought the chariot right in front of Bhishma Pitamaha and Dronacharya, and when Arjuna saw them, he didn't have any hatred towards them. And he wondered that how can I fight now this war? Because I don't hate them, I don't dislike them. There is no need to dislike them to fight a war. It has to be fought because it is dharma, dharma yuddha. So Bhagwan taught this beautiful Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna to develop that right attitude while working in this world. Even while fighting, not with anger, because then you will continue that anger, then you will continue that sense of revenge, then the adharma which was there in the other side will come on this side also. So adharma will not get extinguished. As I said, if the lighted matchstick is thrown in a dry grass or something, that will also catch fire. Then there will be more and more fire only. So without having that anger and hatred and jealousy, one should deal with the world, interact with different beings. So this is the most beautiful expression. Bhagavan says, it's my expression. I am there, I kshama. See, even this prithvi, the earth, one of the name of earth is kshama, because the earth keeps forgiving everyone. We keep on hurting the earth in different ways, but the earth forgives and keeps giving us food, clothing, shelter, everything we gain from this earth. So Bhagavan says, the kshama is myself. Also, when we develop the kshama bhavana, then we manifest Ishvara in our heart. If we have anger, then Ishvara remains hidden. But when we expect forgiveness, then Ishvara alone expresses in our heart as forgiveness. And when Ishvara manifests in our heart, we experience great joy, great sense of peace. So this is a very beautiful quality. So buddhihi jnanam asammohah kshama. Then satyam, Bhagavan says satyam, that is truthfulness, speaking the truth. That is also expression of Ishvara. That is also Ishvara's vibhuti. And what is truthfulness? Shankaracharya ji, he writes in his commentary, ki yatha drishtasya yatha shrutasya cha atmanubhavasya parabuddhi sankrantaye tatha eva uchcharyamana vak satyam uchyate. Very beautiful definition. Bhagavan says, Shankaracharya ji in his commentary, ki yatha drishtasya, whatever we have seen and experienced, yatha shrutasya, whatever we have heard and experienced, means through our senses we keep experiencing this world. Not only world, we interact with different people and listen to them and experience them, and we experience different situations, and we experience there, we gain that experience. Suppose we want to convey this to someone, parabuddhi sankrantaye, we want to make other person understand, convey this, my experience to the other person, then when I convey it as I have experienced, as I have seen, heard, tasted, as I have experienced, when I convey without adding some masala or without removing something, as it is, that Bhagavan says is called satyam. Satyam uchyate, our vani. If I have heard something, then I should convey it as I heard. If I say something different, then it is a lie. If I mention something differently, then it is a lie. Sometimes we lie on purpose. Sometimes unknowingly it happens, but it's a lie. And if we lie, then we create a difference in our own antakkaran. We create a split personality within, which doesn't help us in our spiritual path, nor does it help us in our worldly interaction. Because the buddhi knows what has we have experienced, what we have heard. And when we say something different, the buddhi recognizes that as a lie. Though it is our buddhi, but buddhi recognizes what is true, what is false. And when the buddhi has got this type of thing in the in it, it gets confused. So that moha happens in our life. We will not be able to deal with different situations properly. And when it comes to do upasana or bhakti or meditation, if this lie is there in our buddhi, we will not be able to progress. Then our own buddhi will not accept what the scriptures are saying, because the buddhi is thoroughly confused whether it is true or false. So all sorts of what you call confusion happens in our antakkarana. If we keep lying, sometimes it's better to be quiet than to tell a lie. So that is satyam. In the Mundakopanishad, the rishi says that if you want to attain that supreme satya, that ultimate satyam, then the path towards it also should is satyam. Satyena pantha, satyameva jayate. So satyam is Bhagwan's beautiful vibhuti, and it is one of the most important dharma. In that yam also we say ahimsa satyam. And all the basis of all our interaction with the world should also be on the foundation of satya. Because that satya has disappeared, we require all this bond and stamp paper and witnesses and all those things, and we write and this. Otherwise, in our tradition, in the good old days, once the person utters something, then it is the truth. Even now in villages and all, we see this. Suppose somebody wants to give a land, donate it to someone, he will just utter, the elderly person will just say, ki aaj se ye zameen aapki ho gayi. Bas. Once he has uttered it, then that is it. Because whatever that person utters is true, is satyam. In Ramayana also, the very Bhagwan Shri Ram is dharma avatar, and the very foundation of dharma is satyam. And satyam expressed through our words. Prana jai par vachana na jai, ragukul reet sada chali aahi. Even when we take important steps in our life, even in marriage, the vows are taken, they are uttered by the husband and the wife. So they are satyam. One has to then follow them sincerely. This is true for in all the fields. Even if one becomes a doctor, he has to take a vow that I will follow all these values in my profession. A doctor, a lawyer, an engineer, a politician, a minister, a chief minister, a prime minister, they have to take the shapath. So that is satyam, a very foundation. If one goes against that, then it is asatya. And asatya is adharma. And adharma causes destruction of this whole society. Even this Mahabharata war was fought because of this asatyam only. The kingdom was with Dhritarashtra when these Pandavas went to the forest, and Dhritarashtra had promised them that when you return, we will give back your kingdom to you. But when they returned, they said, no, hum nahi denge. We will not give. So in order to maintain dharma, this war was fought. सो बुद्धे ज्ञानम असम्मोह क्षमा सत्यम देन दमह दमह दम मीन्स वॉट बाह्येन्द्रिय उपशमः कंट्रोल ओवर अवर सेंसेस द आउटर सेंसेस नॉट ओनली द ऑर्गन्स ऑफ परसेप्शन बट ऑर्गन्स ऑफ एक्शन टू हैव कंट्रोल ओवर देम टू मेक देम काम एंड पीसफुल दिस इज द एबिलिटी This is one of the quality which we can develop, dhamma. See, sometimes a person gets angry within and develop that strong urge to say something very harsh. But to prevent our speech from getting expressed, to prevent our anger from getting expressed through our indriyas, to stop them, to stop the indriyas from expressing, is what is called dhamma. It's a very important quality. At all levels, speech, eating, seeing, hearing, tasting, walking, talking, different types of indulgence, all this we do with our karmendriyas, jnanendriyas, one should have total mastery over them. Mastery in such a way that they become, remain calm and peaceful. Even the definition of knowledge which we gain in this world, knowledge, best knowledge is that which makes our senses calm and peaceful. Jnanam, tad jnanam yat prashamakaram yad indriyanam. Which makes our indriyas quiet, that is called knowledge. So, that is called dhamma. Control, self-control means controlling our senses. And this, if we practice, it will be very, very important and helpful. Because the mind sometimes creates a lot of negativities. But when we prevent those negativities from getting expressed, we can control our mind also. But once they start getting expressed, then it becomes more and more difficult. If we cannot control anger, at least control the expressions of anger. If we cannot control jealousy, then at least begin with controlling the expressions of jealousy. Expressions of greed, hatred, violence. So if that is done, then it is a big step towards controlling our mind. Therefore, in the third chapter also we had seen that where Bhagavan says that first, if you want to control your kaam and krodha, then first control your senses. Tasmatvam indriyanyado niyamya bharatarshabha. You first control your senses. So that self-control, control of our senses is called dhamma. And this dhamma is Bhagwan alone expressing. See, Bhagwan's swarup is one, but Bhagwan's expressions are many, billions and trillions, infinite expressions. But Bhagwat swarup is that one, satyam jnanam anantam brahma. Just as I said, the sun, the light of the sun is one white light, but it expresses as different colors. So these are different colors of Bhagwan's Swarupa. His vibhutis are like different colors. But if you trace the colors to their source, it's Bhagwan alone. So Damaha, very important quality. Then Shamaha. Shama means what? Antakkaranasya Upashamaha. Control of our Antakkarana means quietitude of our Antakkarana. Having that control of Antakkarana means control over our raga, dvesha and all. We are able to quieten the mind at any given time. Means the mind is under our control. We are able to just keep the mind calm and peaceful at all times. Means the mind doesn't react to situations and things. See, actions are in our hand, but reactions happen. Suppose somebody says something and I get angry. That's a reaction. Which just happened. But if we develop quality such a way that one doesn't react, one thinks and acts. That means our Antakkaran is under our control. Just like we have the remote control, television is there, and that fellow is blabbering loudly. But when the remote is in our hand, we can just reduce the volume and keep it on mute also. We will see that fellow moving his mouth, but no sound is coming. So that television is under my control or under the control of the remote. Similarly, my own Antakkarana, if it is under the control of some other person or people around, then it is very bad. It is like I am giving my remote control to others. Isko use karo. If you press this, I will get angry. If you do this, I will start dancing. If you do this, I will get annoyed. If you do this, I will become happy. If you do this, I will become unhappy. To give our control of our life to others, not good. We should have full control of our own life, our own Antakkarana. So, that is called Shama. Fully under control. Even if somebody says something very harsh and painful, I don't react, but I think, I decide, and then accordingly I act. Then that is very good. That is good. So Shamaha is a very beautiful quality. Bhagwan says that is my vibhuti, that is my expression. More expressions are there. Sukham dukkham bhavo bhavaha bhayam cha bhayam eva cha ahimsa samata tushtihi tapo danam yasho yashah bhavanti bhava bhutanam matta eva prathak vidhah. More about this we will see in our class tomorrow. Till then, you take care, be happy, safe, peaceful. Do your work, do your sadhana, contemplate on what you heard. Remember Ishvara and time we will meet again tomorrow. Hari Om. Shri Ram Jaya Ram Jaya Jaya Ram. 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 Jaya Jaya Ram Jaya Jaya Ram. Bole Shyama Ramachandra Bhagwan Ki Jai. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.